addition of the SR site review overlay, and the zone change is Z14-5 for Van Slyke. And first, I'd ask if anyone has cell phones that you silence your cell phones, put them on vibrator, that please. And I will start by introducing the planning commissioners. I'm Bill Randall, and I'm currently the chair of the planning commission.
John Jaworski, currently vice chair.
Stephen Baker,
commissioner. Jeff Mills.
John Borofsky.
Rick Duncan.
And Commissioner Taylor is not here tonight. She has recused herself due to a conflict of interest. So before I begin, I do need to go over the hearing procedures. The decision of the Planning Commission on this appeal is quasi-judicial proceedings, so we will use the quasi-judicial format for this public hearing in accordance with applicable code requirements. The purpose of tonight's hearing is to receive relevant testimony on the appeal before us. We may make a decision on the appeal tonight. I want to remind everyone that your testimony must be directed toward the appeal issues and the relevant criteria. Also, no new evidence pertaining to appeal issues can be accepted by the Planning Commission. The Planning Commission can only accept argument and analysis related to evidence that is already in the record. Those wishing to speak during this public hearing should have already submitted a completed request to speak form to us. If you do wish to speak and you've not already done so, please submit that form now. Once the public hearing is opened, speakers will be called in the following order: those in support of the application and the appeal to remove the site review, those with neutral position, and then those opposed to the application or in support of the site review overlay. At the end of testimony, we will ask for any staff response, and then the applicant will have an opportunity for rebuttal. Next, I must remind everyone that the failure to raise an issue with sufficient specificity to allow the Planning Commission and parties to respond will preclude further appeal on that issue. Before we begin, Eugene Code Section 97065 requires that planning commissioners disclose any conflicts of interest, ex parte contacts, or biases, abstentions, or challenges to impartiality. And as I mentioned, Commissioner Taylor has recused herself due to a conflict of interest on this appeal. Do any other commissioners have anything to disclose? Seeing none, now planning staff will provide a brief staff report before we begin testimony. Also, Ann Davies, counsel for the city, is here for assistance with any legal issues.
Becky.
I am Becky Taylor, the staff planner. The subject property is located at 4010 County Farm Road, and at your places is a vicinity map showing the area of request and the surrounding properties. And this, it was in the record before the hearing's official. The zone change request was from C1 Neighborhood Commercial to GO General Office. The hearings official approved the zone change, but with a site review overlay. The applicant appealed the decision primarily because they object to the site review overlay. In your agenda packet, which you received previously, there's a summary of tonight's item. There's a summary of the appeal issues along with staff's response. The appeal statement, which referenced a hearing memo, which I emailed to you in advance, but there's also a copy at your places. And also included in the agenda packet was the hearings official's decision and the Planning Commission's prior decision on what's known as the Benson case. As mentioned by Bill, tonight's item is a public hearing on the appeal of a hearings official's decision. But we also hope that the commission could also begin deliberations tonight. There are four appeal issues, but essentially they all boil down to the applicant objecting to the hearings official's imposition of the site review overlay as part of his approval of the zone change. The applicant has asked the commission to remand the decision back to the hearings official, but staff believes it would be more efficient for the commission to resolve the appeal issues and make its own decision about whether site review should be required. The hearings official's decision to apply the site review overlay was based on three Willikensy area plan policies, which are listed on pages 2 and 3 of attachment A of the agenda packet. The hearings official found these policies to be mandatory approval criteria, and he found that the best way to address these policies was to apply the site review overlay, especially when he considered the Planning Commission's prior decision on the Benson Zone change. In the Benson Zone change, if you'll recall, the hearings official originally did not apply site review, but on appeal, the Planning Commission applied site review, mainly because the Planning Commission found that the development standards in the code were not sufficient to address compatibility, and that the Benson case was about residential properties. So I've included in your places the current commercial code standards, if you need to refer to those if you decide to deliberate tonight. The zone change approval criteria are listed in Eugene Code sections 9.8865. And then lastly, at your places are some letters of support. There's 16 letters of support that we received since the agenda packet went out. Although I asked Ann to be here to talk about what kind of testimony and evidence.
I'll just briefly, I did want to say about the 16 letters of support that came in prior to the hearing, to keep in mind what your scope of review is. You are reviewing the hearings officer's decision, and you're not supposed to be taking new evidence. So that's what I want you to keep in mind when you're looking at those letters. A lot of them have new evidence in them. That, and also when the testimony happens in the this evening, keep in mind that you'll want to be making sure that there's not new evidence that's presented tonight.
So specifically, the new evidence is about the use, which wasn't presented to the hearings official. It was just the zone categories, not for a particular use. So that's something to be careful of. And I can provide more information as needed, but that concludes what I wanted to preface.
Questions of staff? Commissioner Duncan, then Borofsky, then Mills. Please come down the line.
The letters received that I haven't read yet pertain to the use of the property, not the site and zone changes.
Well, do you want to address that?
Yeah, I think the theme of the letters of support are about the use. They're supportive of the proposed use, which wasn't a factor placed before the hearings official in making his decision. So, but overall, the testimony is against the site review overlay. So I think when you're considering the site review overlay, it's not about the use. It's about the zone and maybe the property and the unique circumstances, but not because of this use.
So what you're dealing with is a zone change. And so they're talking
about
what
the proposed use. Actually, we're dealing with an overlay of a SR here, not even a zone change, correct? Because the zone change was...
Well, no, it's part of the zone.
Zone change, too.
Okay.
The overlay was applied as part of the zone change.
Okay.
So...
Semantics. Okay.
I think as you look at, you know, the testimony here and you hear the testimony tonight, that's probably the most common area that we would caution you on, just any references to proposed use as being a basis for your decision on this is something you have to be careful about. It's not that you can't hear the words spoken. You just need to be careful that you rely on any of that information as part of your deliberations and decision.
Would it be appropriate to ask that testimony doesn't speak to that issue, just to help us make sure we're clear on?
I think we would certainly encourage that people stay on the record.
It's hard when you want people to be able to testify,
right.
And
I understand
as far as interrupting and saying, "Oh, that's beyond the record." It's better to take it in and then sift through it and figure out.
Better for us to sort through that, I think. Commissioner Borofsky?
Yeah, I guess it was just my question was we can read the letters. We can see what they have to say, but don't let the use of the property weigh in on the decision that we're going to be making.
Correct. Okay. Commissioner Mills?
I'll hold till later.
Okay. Any other questions of staff and the commission? Commissioner Baker?
Yeah, I looked at the Eugene Code, and I just wanted to confirm that I looked at the Eugene Code related to the GO, so I have background. Mm-hmm. So the section on allowable uses and also the zone development standards. And I just wanted to confirm that the copy that I happened to print, because I didn't get it off the web, it was 2013. Is that still the current date? 416, 2013, section for example, on page 9.2-13, is that still a current date? And there weren't further changes made.
Yeah. There's a packet at your place that is from the current code. That might be the easiest way
okay.
to
it's in there.
Address
okay.
that.
Yeah. All right.
Okay.
Okay. Well, I will now open the public hearing with those in support of the application. And, Commissioner Jaworski will officially call Mr. Close up. But,
okay. Our first speaker is speaking for is Mr. Bill Close, and he will be followed by Carol Schirmer.
Schirmer.
Okay.
Are there time limits on this?
For sure.
I only need an hour and a half.
How about?
how long? I could use 10 to 15 minutes, and I think told my fellow travelers to count on 5 max.
I think that's totally reasonable. Thank you.
Folks, I'm Bill Close, 375 West 4th Avenue, Suite 204 in Eugene. I'm representing, throughout this proceeding, I've been representing the applicant, who is the contract seller for the property, and Cascade Health Solutions, who's the contract buyer. What I passed out tonight is the cheat sheet that I'm going to use tonight to keep myself on track. So I won't read this stuff, but I just wanted to get down in writing the key points that I wanted to make for you tonight. In our initial appeal, we asked that you seriously consider remanding this back to the hearings official because we're confident, with like a 0.9 degree of confidence, that if he gets it back from you, he will not impose site review, which is what we asked him not to do. If staff doesn't want you to send it back, you have discretion to send it back. If you do send it back, we waive the 120-day timeline. We're pretty confident we'll do okay with him. Now, if you folks on your own want to strip site review, that'd be great too. I agree with staff, that would be more efficient. What we don't want to do is leave this proceeding with site review stuck on our foreheads. The reason we made a very strong pitch to the planning director prior to the staff report not to impose site review. We made the same pitch to the hearings official not to impose site review, and we made the same pitch to you in our appeal. Site review went on at the recommendation of staff, who made the request artfully and strenuously, and primarily based on this commission's decision in the Benson matter. Now remember, Benson was a zone change having to do with residential from R1 to R2. Here we're dealing with commercial, C1 to GO. Benson was going from a kinder, gentler zone to a rougher zone, upzoning. We're going from a rougher zone to a kinder, gentler zone, from C1 down to GO. Big picture, we don't think that it's appropriate for the hearings official to look to Benson and draw absolute conclusions about what to do in this case. Yet, that's the way the staff pitched it to the hearings official. And the hearings official, in summary, going through all of the previous site review add-on, strip-off decisions of the last 10 years, and looking at all the standards, and he slogged through them in great fashion, he wound up saying, you know, if it was up to me, I would stick with previous hearings official decisions and I wouldn't impose site review. But staff has given me the Benson decision, I've digested that, and I think if this matter were in front of the Planning Commission, they would impose site review. So I'm going to do it. And that's what got us here. The crankshaft, I call it the crankshaft, maybe motherboard is a more contemporary metaphor, of the hearings official's rationale is at the bottom of page one of my cheat sheet, right there. That is it. He said, if the Planning Commission had not reversed the hearings official's position on site review in the Benson case, I might well agree with the applicant and prior hearings officials that the site review overlay should not be applied, given the Planning Commission's decision in Benson and Planning Commission review authority over zone change requests such as this, I agree with the staff that the site review overlay is necessary to ensure compliance the mandatory approval criteria of Willikensee Area Plan Policy 2 and 5. Site review overlay is therefore made a condition of approval. So that's what stung us, and that's what we're requesting relief from, and that's why we're saying, please, send it back, because he's saying in the first sentence, if it were up to me, I wouldn't be imposing site review. And our basic kind of theoretical pitch to you is, at each stage of this proceeding, any applicant should be entitled to a decision by the decision maker based on their own best judgment, their own best reading of the law and the facts. We didn't get that from the hearings official. We look at this crankshaft paragraph here and we think his best judgment is no site review, but he feels constrained by the Planning Commission. And we don't think that's right. The applicant's entitled to his best judgment. This commission's entitled to his best judgment. Everybody makes their best judgment, as between the hearings official and the Planning Commission, without talking about, you know, what level of the mountain each is on. Each of those decision-making bodies has the same ability to interpret the law. It's only the City Council that has a special insight because it's their law. So really the hearings official is saying the planning staff sold me on the notion that the planning staff sold me on the notion that the Planning Commission would rely on this Willikensee Area Policy 2 and decide to impose site review. And our second most basic pitch to you tonight is that conclusion is legally wrong. We argued strenuously to the staff and then to the hearings official and now to you. This Willikensee Area Plan Policy 2 is not to be applied to individual land use applications. It is instead a policy that is directed at the city to go forth and adopt law. Go adopt code that does this. It's a basic distinction in standards that that are on the table in any land use application. You have to look at the list of standards and you need to say, now, which one of these are mandatory and which one of these are directives to the city to do something and which of these are standards that to be applied in reviewing this particular application. Policy 2, in our view, is directive to the city. It's not something that's to be applied as a decision-making standard for this application. The hearings official applied it. Staff said to apply it. We said don't apply it. And that the entirety of that policy, too, is quoted right smack in the middle of the page 2 of my cheat sheet there. It says, the city shall ensure that future commercial development and redevelopment in the Willikensee planning area is sensitive to and compatible with existing and planned development in the surrounding area. So our view is, city, go forth and adopt some code, make some law, not do this in the context of our application. The one new piece of information that I've put in my cheat sheet here for you tonight is a quote at the bottom of page 2 here from Luba's decision in Bothman versus City of Eugene, 51 Oregon, Luba, 2006. I'm a little embarrassed to say that I was involved in that case. There were three decisions in that chunk of litigation. This Bothman involved a piece of ground that's on the west side of Coburg Road, just north of the Dairy Queen, the world famous Dairy Queen. 2 acres, it was C1, owners wanted C2. City said, no, you can't have C2 because this property is plan designated medium density residential. And the applicant said, we said, no, it's plan designated commercial. And so the city denied it, and Luba repealed it. Luba said, you know, it's plan designated commercial. Go try again. So in round 2, on remand, the city tried again, starting with the assumption that it was plan designated commercial. And then they had to apply the Willikensee area plan policies. And the opponents, of course, Dairy Queen and others, were looking at policies in the Willikensee area plan, including policy 2, same one that staff and the hearings officials are relying on here, including policy 2, and saying this policy applies directly, you got to say no to this zone change. And this commission, all of you folks who were here 10 years ago, maybe Commissioner Duncan, maybe nobody else, not that anybody should be bragging about that, this commission said no, policy 2 is directed at the city to adopt law. It's not a standard to be applied in the context of any site-specific application. And so that issue went up to Luba on appeal with the Dairy Queen and others saying, apply policy 2. It's a standard for a rezoning decision. And Luba said, well, Eugene Planning Commission said it's not. a standard. It's directive to the city to go forth and adopt law. And Luba's exact words appear there at the bottom of page 2. The very last paragraph, I quoted from the Luba decision there, and the very last paragraph of that quote, last paragraph on page 2, Luba said, "The Planning Commission found that Policy 2 is a planning directive to the city, as indicated by the accompanying, quote, proposed actions, which direct the city to, one, amend the code in certain ways, and, two, apply the site review overlay to all parcels zoned C1 or C2. According to the Planning Commission, the city has fulfilled both actions. We agree with the city that Policy 2 is a planning directive to the city and not a policy potentially applicable to a quasi-judicial zoning application." That's us. So what we're suggesting to you is please follow this commission's interpretation from Bothman as blessed by Luba in the Luba decision and conclude similarly that Policy 2, which is advocated by staff for imposing site review and was relied upon by the hearings official to apply site review, based on the hearings official guess about what you might do if this matter were in front of you, and say, you know, Policy 2 does not apply, and so really the crankshaft basis for applying site review is not there. So strip site review or send it back to the hearings official so we can get his own best judgment. That is the big picture. I have a few words there on page 3 of my cheat sheet about Policy 5. I've quoted some language from the staff report that basically indicates that even the staff agrees that GO zone would be consistent with the other multifamily residential and commercial uses that are on various sides of this property. And I guess my last point would be a point I made in my appeal statement, is that this is rough. I mean, here what we're doing is going from a rougher zone, C1, that allows a rougher bunch of characters on the street, to a kinder, gentler zone, which is GO. That's the nature of the GO zone. It was designed to be more gentle, to provide transition between the uses on site and adjacent uses. That material cited in our, that language from the code is cited in our various materials. Just for fun, because I had too much time to prepare for this hearing, on the last, on the page 5 of my cheat sheet there, I compared the uses that are allowed in the C1 zone and the uses that are allowed in the GO zone. And so what I have on page 5 is a list of uses that are allowed outright or conditionally allowed in the C1 zone that are not allowed or allowed with greater restrictions in the GO zone. So these are all the things that you can do or you can do more easily in the C1 zone than you can in the GO zone. And you look down there and you think, what a great collection of things. And then you turn to the next page, 6, and what I've done here is I've culled out the uses that are allowed or conditionally allowed in the GO zone that are not allowed or are more restricted in the C1 zone. And it's a different collection of uses. In the middle is nursing home. My client needs nursing home use, and that's why they're going to GO. But you look at this list of use and you say, well, that's a kind of a mixed bag too. And then you look at this list and you look at the earlier list and you think, what goes into these lists? In the aggregate, kind of the macro level, I think it's fair to say that the uses listed on page 6 for the GO zone are more moderate uses. They generate fewer externalities for the adjacent or surrounding uses than do the uses that are on page 5, which are the uses for the C1 zone. That's just my take on it. So that's the big picture. I think I've overshot my 15 minutes a little bit. I look forward to doing rebuttal after the staff comes back and argues for keeping site review in there. Unless anybody has any questions for me at this point.
Questions at this point?
I've got a couple questions. Okay. One, when he referred to nursing homes, is what he wants, is that the use, and was that new testimony?
It is new testimony.
Well, I think he was just talking about what the uses were.
Yeah.
I mean, okay.
So to the extent that it's listed in the code as an allowed use or conditionally allowed use, it's not new testimony.
And then the other question that I had was, there is one difference. You kept referring that the GO is a kinder, gentler zone than commercial. I did notice that the height limits in GO is 50 feet and in C1 is 35 feet. No. So is that more gentle?
You know, kinder, gentler is in the eyes of the beholder. I don't know. I mean, I can certainly understand you saying, hey, anything that's 50 feet in the zone is worse than something that's 35 in the zone. Okay. You know, how do you measure kinder, gentler? Is it, you know, level of traffic, lights and glare, noise, dust, noise? I don't know.
All right. Hey.
Thanks.
Carol Shermer, okay, followed by Cheryl Boyum.
Good evening, staff and planning commissioners. My name is Carol Shermer. I'm with Shermer Satry Group. I'm also at 375 West 4th, Eugene, 97401. I'm here to speak as a landscape architect that uses the land use code and makes applications for clients for conditional use permits and site reviews, and maybe to speak a little bit about what it is, sort of boots on the ground, what site review might actually mean in a case like this. And I just wanted to add one follow-up to what Bill Close was saying. The current zone is C1 with no site review on it, which allows some, I guess we're going to call them rougher uses. And to your point, Mr. Borofsky, I think some of the roughness is maybe the use, the intensity of the use. And so now we're going to a more transitional zone, which is GO, and now we're going to apply site review. And I think part of the problem lies in, and I found this in other projects, that the neighborhood refinement plans are old and we're still using them. And, you know, I pulled up my old code. I still have a copy of the old code because it's actually still in effect on one of my projects. And site review was a list of fairly nebulous criteria, and, you know, some efficient, workable, safe interrelationships among buildings, signs and illumination. So what has happened in since then is we now have a land use code that covers all of this very extensively. You can pick out every one of these site review items back in the day when that refinement plan was thinking about applying site review to certain uses, and now the code covers it all. We have safe and efficient ingress and egress. Well, we have access management standards that deal with that, Chapter 9 and Chapter 7. We have a sign code that deals with signs and illumination. We also have a lighting code that deals with illumination and zero emission across the property lines. Safe and efficient ingress and egress is access management standards. Parking, that's a land use code, and we also have adequate planting. We have stormwater management plans code, which is a whole book in and of itself. So the code back in the day never contemplated all of that, but as we fast forward to now, we've got all of those standards. So I went through the current site review standards and really couldn't find anything there either that's not covered by the standard code if someone were to submit for just a building permit. And so what really happens here is an addition of time and money to the client, regardless of who the client is. And the only other criterion that you're going to run into in site review is compatibility. And yet the land use code has been updated to create that compatibility. Safe and efficient ingress and egress, stormwater, lighting, building height, bulk height, scale, glare, odor, all of that. So there really isn't anything left in site review from a public process side of things to evaluate it on except compatibility, and compatibility is not defined any further than it meets the code criterion that we already have. So that leaves it really open to interpretation. And from the time aspect, you know, I know we all talk about the 120-day rule on a site review application, but in reality, there's the pieces that the design team has to create in order to submit for a site review application. So on a project like this, and you don't know what the project is, it's typically between the architect and the civil engineer and the landscape architect and the land use planner. It's 3 months to prepare the documents that meet the site review criteria. You turn it in, you have a 30-day completeness review. They're never complete because they're complicated. You redo the items, say you can get that done in 2 weeks to a month. You turn it back in for more completeness review. It's deemed complete. then it goes through a 45-day staff review process, then it goes staff report, then an appeal process. So typically there's 6 to 8 months. Whereas without site review, the client could assemble the team, we could do our 2 to 3 months worth of work, turn in for building permit, start building, because it's an outright allowed use on the list. And then there's the cost aspect of it. It adds additional cost, so it's a time and cost, and in the end, the product will look no different. Because we have parking lot standards, we have planting standards, we have stormwater standards, we have building height standards, we have window standards, setbacks. So site review will only add time and cost, and then the potential for appeal, which has been happening more often than not on projects. I mean, you've seen them. And that and I can't even talk about the time and cost of that. That's LUBA appeals potentially on to Court of Appeals, and after a while it becomes so onerous that clients walk away from those projects or don't even start them. So these are the boots on the ground implications of site review. That has nothing to do with the law, whether you're going to apply it, send it back to the hearings officer. But I just wanted you to understand the realities of having site review on that. It really doesn't gain anyone anything, and it's a great loss potentially to the community if this project doesn't go forward, and it's a financial risk for the client. So I think that's all I have.
Any questions?
Okay,
thanks.
Mr. Baker.
Well, I had just a quick question. So, I mean, I was looking through the code requirements. So one of the primary differences is the height, right? So one of the ways to have approached this would be to potentially go for a geo zone with a height limit of 35 feet, right? And then that would have...
It's a possibility. I would resist tweaking the code at that level, but
The point is, I mean, that would have
sure
made the compatibility in terms of the height
is one of the criteria.
Yes, I'm wondering, are we kind of stepping?
Yeah.
Okay.
We're
right.
Kind of stepping out of.
All right.
Yeah. So, okay. Thanks.
Our next speaker is Cheryl Boyman, followed by Margie Brooks.
Good evening. I'm Cheryl Boyham. I'm a resident of Eugene. I'm also the CEO of Cascade Health Solutions, which is a nonprofit healthcare organization who has a rich history of providing healthcare services to residents of Lane County for the past 35 years. Our mission is to meet unmet health needs. I'm here tonight to testify in favor of removing the site review from this property. Cascade Health Solutions currently is under contract to purchase this property. Our intended use is to build a hospice house for residents of our community. I have four reasons that I would like to put before you as to why I believe the site review should be lifted. But I would like to take a few minutes just to explain what a hospice house is. I realize this is not a part of what you're going to make your decisions on, but I think it would help you to fully understand what our intended use is. So with your permission, I'll be brief, but just briefly explain what a hospice house is. Is that okay? Thank you. A hospice house is really an important option for end-of-life care. For those who have a terminal illness, you know, most of those people would prefer to receive care in their own home, surrounded by people that they know and love. But unfortunately, this is just not possible sometimes. There are times when the patient maybe has a higher level of care that is required that can't be delivered in the home. There are times that the caregiver is just facing burnout and they need help. There are other times that an individual just doesn't have a caregiver to provide any care. And as a hospice provider, we've actually treated many homeless people. So in this situation, a hospice house really presents an option for them that both honors their preference to receive care in a home environment and also receive the kind of care that they need. Currently in our community, the only options available for these people would be to go into a hospital or into an actual nursing home. And there are three distinguishing factors that distinguish a hospice house from a hospital and nursing home. Just very briefly, one is a hospice house looks and feels like a home. It's usually single story, has, you know, family living areas, private bedroom suites. It looks like a home. Secondly, there is a major connection with nature with a hospice house. If you look around the country, the sightings of hospice houses are usually on acreage, and there is a strong connection with nature. There's landscaping, native plants, walking trails, water features, tranquility gardens, butterfly gardens, and even wildlife. Those things create an environment for the hospice patient that really provides serenity, peace, and beauty, and that's been really important for end-of-life care. Finally, the other thing that distinguishes them is the people who are in a hospice house receive all their care from a professional hospice team that's experienced and dedicated to end-of-life care. And these people really provide emotional, spiritual, and physical support and care to both the individual and the family. So just overall, a hospice house is really like a home away from home, where people can receive compassionate care in a setting that's respectful, that's dignified, quiet, and beautiful. There's a huge need in our community for a hospice house, and you'll find that individual physicians, Lane County Medical Society, and both hospitals have endorsed our project and are very supportive. If anything, in the last few years, the need has really escalated, has become almost urgent in our community. So it is a definite need here. So speaking for Cascade Health Solutions, I would just like to propose four reasons to consider removing site review. The first one is that our intended use, the footprint, would have minimal impact on this property or surrounding properties. The plans that we have designed would take about a third of an acre. The property is 4.79 acres. That's 7% of the footprint of the property. The rest would be landscaped and have the pool that's there, the pond, and walking trails. The second reason is the neighbors are all supportive. I've personally reached out and talked to every single neighbor that owns property that is borders this property. All of them have been verbally supportive. In the letters that you mentioned, you will find letters from First Baptist Church, from Camp Harlow, from the Buchanans, from Mark Lewis, Kristen Holbrook, and Scott Aldridge, all who are supportive of our use of that property. Thirdly, as Carol just mentioned, the site review would really create a significant burden to Cascade Health Solutions as a nonprofit. This burden would be in time, 6 to 8 months of time, and the cost, which has actually been estimated to be around $100,000. The burdens of these burdens are really significant enough that probably if site review was not removed, Cascade Health Solution would most likely not purchase the property, and that would be an incredible impact to our community. Finally, as has been mentioned, the property was previously zoned as C1. Obviously, I'm not a land use expert, but just from what I have heard and have read, C1 did not have overlay of site review. The GO zone, which is more gentle, has a site review attached. Just from a non-land use person, this doesn't make logical sense. So in closing, a hospice house is really a pressing unmet need in our community. There are people right now who have a desperate need for this. Cascade Health Solutions has actually been trying to build a hospice house for 8 years. And because of land use and zoning challenges, our community is still without a hospice house, which is very unusual for a house or a community our size. So I would just like to respectfully ask that the Planning Commission would remove the requirement for site review for this property, or send it back to the hearing official for further review. And I just really thank you for your serious consideration of this request. Thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Boyle.
Margie Brooks, followed by Bill Newland.
Good evening. I'm Margie Brooks. I'm executive director of our foundation at Cascade Health Solutions. Much of what I'm going to say is just repeat of what's been before me, but I'm speaking in support of request for removal of the site review of the overlay of the property at 4010 County Farm Road. Again, as was cited before, it was Zone C1. We changed the zoning to GO, and while this is a kind, as we've heard from many testimony already, it's a kinder, gentler transition zone, and the overlay was not a requirement on C1. Cascade Health Solutions is a nonprofit organization with a mission of meeting unmet health care needs in our community. We have been looking for a piece of property for a hospice house, as Cheryl said, for a very long time. All the while, people have lost their fight for life, been forced to spend their last days in either a hospital or a nursing home. This is not our desire for these people. They deserve better from us. Other communities that we have researched with hospice houses in them have had donated parkland, changed zoning laws, and helped build their hospice house. Our community continues to put up costly hurdles, and we still do not have a home for these people. It is estimated this overlay would cost upwards to $100,000 for our organization, and as you heard, around 8 months to get through the process on a good day. We urge you to do the right thing and lift the site overlay and let us build this peaceful home for the people who cannot help themselves. So thank you very much.
Grant, who did I say? Bill Newland, followed by Grant Spies. Bees, okay.
Good evening. I'm Bill Newland. I'm with Campbell Commercial Real Estate, 701 High Street in Eugene. I'm a real estate broker and have worked with Cascade Health Solutions over the last few years. As Cheryl and Margie mentioned, they've been looking for a site for a hospice house and been in the process of doing that for about 8 years. And a hospice house is a service that's greatly needed in our area. The site that's under consideration is nearly 5 acres. The hospice house is only 12 bedrooms. It's a very low-density use and therefore would be a very natural transition between the agricultural uses to the north and the commercial and residential uses to the south. The natural beauty and pastoral setting of this site is what attracted Cascade Health Solutions to the property initially. And while these attributes lend themselves for a peaceful environment for the hospice house, they also make it the effective transition between the urban and rural areas, which is the city's desire. Also, the GO zoning, as proposed, is less intensive than the current C1 zoning. There was no site review required previously, and it does not make sense to add it when the new zone is less intensive than the previous. As previously mentioned, the site review will add significant time and cost to the project. Cascade Health Solutions can afford neither of these. We're in the middle of a real estate transaction, Cascade's acquisition of the property, and the additional time and cost components both put this transaction and project in jeopardy. In my business, we call these hurdles deal killers. The site review, if not reversed by the commission or sent back to the hearing official for reconsideration, will most likely be a deal killer for this project. For these reasons, I encourage the Planning Commission to take the necessary steps to remove the site review or to send it back to the hearings official for reconsideration. Thank you.
Thank you.
Grant Spees. This will be our last.
Okay.
Good evening. My name is Grant Spees. I'm the director of Camp Harlow and represent First Baptist Church as well. First Baptist Church and Camp Harlow combined own over 200 acres immediately adjacent to the proposed site. And, you know, I want to testify, we have great fear about how the land around us will be developed, because we're a 65-year-old youth camp where it looks like we're way in the country, but we are within a few hundred yards of the urban growth boundary. And what goes on around us can have a huge impact on our camp. We have 3,000 kids there in the summer months, plus a year-round activity, other youth activity and adult activity. And there are sounds that come out of a youth camp when there's 300 kids a week there having a great time. And we have a farming operation on 150 or so of those acres that creates dust. And so our concern is, what's going to happen next to us? And, you know, as we talk about those various zoning uses, what can go on 4 acres, and what's our exposure to somebody saying, we don't like what we're seeing and hearing from what we do there? So I was pretty thrilled to hear about Cascade Health Solutions' plans of putting a hospice house there as being a, I can't think of a use that would be less of a potential conflict with what we do than a hospice house. And not to mention the personal societal value of what goes on there. And we have talked with them, communicated with them about our stuff, and they've assured us that what we do there, the farming operations and the camp, would have no impact on them. It would not be a concern to them at all. And I know what they do. I mean, we just think it's great on many levels, but we just see an opportunity to take that space to be used in a way that will be very compatible with what we do. An aside, this summer we had some people from a nursing home out in our camp when the kids were there, and these kids just gravitated to these oldsters. It was an amazing thing to see, and my director of program and I were just talking about what it might be like if our camp were to partner with this facility that's really close by, just to come in and let these kids interact with some older folks and let these older folks have the joy of seeing some kids. So it's just, that has nothing to do with this discussion, except it would please us if any barriers to this potential facility that are unnecessary could be removed. If you guys have the ability to do that, it would that'd be a real plus for what we do in that place and been doing for a long, long time. So that's all, unless there's questions.
Thank you, Mr. Spees.
Thank you.
Well, that is the extent of the green cards that we have of those wishing to speak in support. And we would next ask if any speakers have a neutral position. We'd like to invite them. I'm guessing none. And we still have to go through it. And then those speakers opposed to the application are now invited. Seeing none, we'll move on to staff response and follow-up.
You want me to go first? There, as you walk through this, hoping Becky and Steve are going to help walk you through this, because there are a lot of issues. But there are a lot of legal issues, and I don't want to bring them all up right now. I'd rather do that as you go through the process. But the one thing that I do want to mention is the Bothman case. Because Mr. Close is correct that in Bothman, this planning commission did say this is a directive to the city. Therefore, it's not a mandatory approval criterion. And that went up to LUBA. And there is language in a LUBA decision, and I think that you had that in your packets, talking about policy two. So it quotes the language of the policy, but not the proposed actions. And I'm just going to read the language from LUBA so you have it in your minds. The Planning Commission found that Policy 2 is a planning directive to the city, as indicated by the accompanying proposed actions, which direct the city to, 1, amend the code in certain ways, and 2, apply the site review overlay to all parcels zoned C1 or C2. According to the Planning Commission, the city has fulfilled both actions. We agree with the city that Policy 2 is a planning directive to the city and not a policy potentially applicable to a quasi-judicial rezoning application. So you have language here that suggests a previous planning commission might have decided something differently than what you could decide here and what you maybe already decided in Benson. So as I want to explain the legal framework. You're allowed as a planning commission to interpret something differently than you did in the past. It's not a good idea to flip-flop. So you don't want in one application make one interpretation, the next week make another one, and go back and forth. You can correct something that was an error, or you can say, you know, you could explain why a particular interpretation was made the way it was. This, I think, along with Benson that you decided a while back, kind of gives you a platform to get deep into these issues and figure out how you want to move forward, because you do want to be consistent moving forward with how you look at this policy and how whether you're considering it a mandatory approval criterion, and to the extent that you are, what does that mean, and to the extent that you aren't, what does that mean in relation to a specific zoning application. So you can, you know, big picture, I would be able to support applying or not applying the site review. There's support in the law for either way. Yeah.
Commissioner Duncan.
Since you brought up Benson, would this be appropriate for me to ask you about Benson at this point in time?
You could. I may not be able to answer all your questions, but I will have an opportunity to write a memo if we need to do that.
Well, my question is that Benson was appealed to LUBA, and because it was in an appeal, we have been instructed not to pay attention to what's going on in case it was remanded back to us. And since it hasn't had a decision yet, how can we rely on Benson that may not be valid from a decision that we made if it's remanded for some appeal? So how does that case stand as something to be decided on by this planning commission since it's still in an appeal process?
Yeah, it's
knowing laws, you don't typically rely on a law or a standing in court that's in an appeal process.
Right. Well, that decision, I'm trying to remember the context, you made that decision. That's a valid decision. I'm not sure what direction you were given as far as let's not talk about, let's ignore it. It's more, don't talk to people in the process because it could come back to you and you don't want to violate your
ability.
Well,
we typically don't pay attention to what's going on at LUBA for these appeals.
Yeah. Well, it hasn't been doing anything anyway, so there's nothing to know. But as far as the legal status of that, you made a decision. You made an interpretation that said something. Arguably, that interpretation is maybe a little different than what the Planning Commission said back in Bothman. So you can look at that for that reason to say, okay, what did we do in Benson? What did we do in Bothman? What are we doing here? And what do we want to do going forward?
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Mr. Baker?
I just have a quick question that I assume would be legal. When was the WAP plan adopted?
When was WAP?
92.
Okay. Just trying to put it in context.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mr. Mills.
Yeah, a question for council. I guess I'm having a hard time seeing that Bothman and Benson carry equal but opposing potentially findings, because my recollection of Benson was it was a partial specific decision based upon a very complicated history for that parcel. And I'm looking, Steve's looking like he wants to jump in there too. And Bothman, I've read a little bit. This seemed to be more of a very general kind of a statement. And I think I tried very hard in the case of Benson to keep in mind that we were trying to address a particular very complicated history on the parcel in question.
So the vast majority of what you dealt with in the Benson case is really not what is kind of relevant to this discussion.
Exactly,
it's
yeah.
not the base zone question that's at issue. If you recall, you spent probably 90% of your time on the questions you're referring to, and the last bit of your deliberations dealt with should site review be applied or not. And that's really the only part of Benson that's really critical here. So the complicated history, all those issues really are not a part of this discussion as much in terms of the the other designation issues that you had to grapple with. What's really at issue here is how you evaluated the WAP policies and their applicability toward the site review question. The hearings official in that case said that site review was not required. You reversed that. You modified the decision to include site review as part of that.
But once again, to me, my recollection is that we were once again engaged in trying to untangle this very complicated history for this parcel. Now, when I've read what I've read for the findings, I'm a little troubled by the fact that we're taking this site review recommendation for this parcel and this situation and trying to apply it broadly to say, well, that means site review might be required in general for...
Right.
Now, that also brings up another question that I have, and I'll ask later, but it gets into, you know, where are we with the Willa-Kinzie Area Plan and its requirements for C1 and C2 site review?
So I think the last part of what you were saying in terms of, you know, kind of untangling in the site review question and how it's relevant here is starting to dive in deeper into the deliberations. I think it'll be more helpful if we kind of walk through that in a little orderly fashion. So I think it's kind of the heart of some of the matter, though, and I think so that's an area we want to take a little bit more time, and I think once we get to deliberations, okay, we'll go there.
Commissioner Borowski.
Just Paula, a couple of questions. Who was planning director on this decision? Was it you or was it Carolyn?
Must have been Carolyn.
Okay. Yeah. Just for my knowledge. And then I guess the other question would be as far as procedure going forward. If it's the will of the commission to remove site review, what is staff's recommendation for the best way to do that? Would it be better to remand it back, such as is asked for in the appeal, or is there another way that would be simpler and more expeditious?
Well, I think as we stated in the staff report, I think the simpler way would be for you just to overturn that decision, basically reverse the decision and take the site review away. That will also be important for the hearings official because it provides clarity to him in terms of how he saw you view the Willa-Kinzie plan, and perhaps in doing so you're citing distinctions between what you did in Benson and what you're doing here, which will be helpful. So for us, it seems like if you're going to get to the point where you believe the hearings official needs to reconsider, what I believe you're coming to the conclusion is that he got it wrong in some fashion, keep moving forward with the appeal and make that decision right here and now, as opposed to remanding it to the hearings official. We wouldn't even know necessarily what that answer would be from the hearings official. And so we believe, at least, it's in everyone's best interest, if you're going that way, to make that decision here rather than remand and wait to see what happens.
And then we would then at that point put forward in our findings how we got to that and why we felt it was wrong and that we're moving forward this way.
Right. That's correct. And so there as we get into the discussion, you know, there are some differences, obviously, between Benson in this case. Even the zoning itself is different. And so as we walk through those, that's part of what I think you as a body need to grapple with is how analogous are some of the things that you did in Benson to this case. That's part of what we want to talk about. And, again, I think getting into that will be a good part of the deliberations.
Okay, and then one more. So then if that's the direction we go, do we still have to do findings for for all of the errors that have been brought up by the applicant?
You want to walk through them.
Yes.
Thank you.
Commissioner Mills.
Real quickly, was GEO in existence at the time that Willa-Kinzie Area Plan was implemented?
Yes.
It was.
Okay. It talks about it in the web.
Thank you.
Commissioner Baker.
Yeah, and I had a question regarding that, too. Two questions. So if this site review was removed, or whatever. So currently, if the GEO zone is approved, so anything that meets the criteria for the GEO zone can go in there. Is that correct? It's not limited at all to the proposed
right.
So anything if the sale doesn't go through, something else could go in there tomorrow that's completely different. That's
right.
That would be able to. Okay. And I was curious if there was any GO zone in the Willikensy area in 1992.
Apparently there was.
Well, that's the GO zone property in the
Willikensy.
Because otherwise, you know, when you develop the refinement plan, you kind of base it upon what you're familiar with. So, you know, that would be it to me.
Okay.
There was.
I remember GO zones from, I think, the 80s.
Well, not that it doesn't exist, but there was some in the Willikensy area.
And I recall some there.
Is that new?
Okay. So I did a project there.
Yeah, that would be new.
With that zone. So
that would be new. It's all over the place.
I think we are, is staff complete on, okay? Then applicant can have a chance at rebuttal.
Thank you, commissioners. Back to the boring legal stuff again. I was always surprised how Benson decisions snuck into this proceeding at all. I mean, staff brought it in because it was it was their rationale for recommending site review, but as has been discussed here, and as we pointed out to the hearings official, it involved residential zone change, not commercial. And this policy, too, which is the touchstone policy for the hearings official, based on what we thought the Planning Commission would do, that policy wasn't even involved in Benson because it's a commercial policy, not a residential policy. So Benson it's irrelevant, largely irrelevant. Carol Shermer's testimony was much better than mine because she focused on the disutility of site review. And so I want to use that as a springboard to make a few more comments in a little harsher terms. Site review is a panda's thumb of the zoning code. It's a leftover from the old zoning code. As Carol walked you through in some detail, and which you could get into in more detail, 99.9% of everything you get out of site review is already in the new code. Remember, we had a total makeover of the code in 2001. We were all involved in that. It was very exciting. The code went from this thick to this thick. And Luba reviewed it in an 80-page opinion. She went through the particulars, but really, if you impose site review, you don't get an increment of improvement in decision making or life that warrants a 1-year delay and $100,000 cost. What really ought to happen is somebody ought to go through the zoning code and cull out all the site review stuff. It's kind of like if the zoning code were a camel. Sticks just go on the camel. They never come off. That's kind of the way it is with zoning codes. It's very hard to take stuff out because nobody gets professionally rewarded for pulling stuff out that's now redundant and surplusage and just slows things down and costs more money. But that really is the character of site review in substantial measure. I think that ends my remarks. I actually had the temerity to draft up short decision documents for the commission. I gave them to the city attorney. Each one's 2 pages long. One says you're deciding to send it back to the hearing official. The other one says we're deciding to strip site review. I know the city likes to draft its own opinion. Some jurisdictions like to have the person that has the stake in the matter and is going to have to defend its site draft the findings, and so I tend to do that. If you're inclined to strip site review, all the better. Just do it. And I think if you're inclined to do that, there's no need for long, detailed findings addressing all the issues in the appeal. Just one basic issue, you know, impose site review or not. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And with that, I'll close the public hearing. And given our limited scope and review, I think we can deliberate tonight. And with that, get to what we need to do first. I guess what I'd like to do is maybe get a sense from each commissioner on whether they think the hearings official erred in applying site review, and just kind of get a sense of maybe which way you're leaning before we dive into this.
Point of order.
Commissioner Borofsky.
There is more testimony that was given to us at the table. Do you think it would be appropriate for us to look at that?
Which testimony? Well, you mean what Mr. Close gave?
No, the eight letters.
The letters.
In front of us. From.
The letters we didn't receive till this evening.
Welsh.
Right.
And the Welsh decision.
Welsh boys.
Which eight letters are those? Did I see those? Are those new tonight?
I think the letters reflect what you heard in the testimony about.
That's staff's opinion.
Okay. Right. So look. Yeah, I'd say. I think what you should do is you should look at it, and then there should be something in your decision that says we took in this testimony. We didn't reject it out of hand, but we've reviewed it, and we're only considering the stuff that is not new evidence.
Okay. Mr. Duncan.
I agree that we should look at those. I wonder at what point are we ready to start deliberation? Or should we still have questions more of staff at this point? Take some time to do that and then move to deliberations.
Okay. I think that might be appropriate. Maybe take a few minutes to ask questions of staff of what we might have. I know I do have a few questions, at least to get out on the table.
Yeah.
And then maybe we can decide if we feel we're ready to go ahead and deliberate.
Sit out and read.
Break.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, to me, written testimony is equivalent to somebody coming here and sitting in the chair. They just weren't available to do that. Mm-hmm. So that it's going to be the same. Some of it might be similar to what was brought up here, but there may be points in there that would help us make our decision.
Okay. Maybe we can do that in 5 or 10 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay. Who'd like to start? Commissioner Duncan.
Yeah, a couple of questions. As I read through the Wilkins Refinement Plan, there are places where it actually talks about general commercial properties, and I guess maybe this is deliberation, I'm not sure, but it talks about general commercial properties. It talks about GO in some places. And then, in particular, a couple of the policies that have been brought forward, in particular, page 15, policy 2.2. It goes back and it starts referring to C1 neighborhood commercial and C2 general commercial as specific zone classifications and doesn't refer to GO as a zone classification.
That's why I asked about GO.
But yet other places it talks about GO and commercial and C lands and things like that. So I'm looking for, have we had a policy discussion that when it talks about C1 and C2 in particular, that should include GO, or is it really referring to C1 and C2 and not GO? Maybe that's a deliberation question. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I don't know that that's anything that you guys can answer.
No, I don't know that we can. I think that's a question for you to ponder because of the way that policy 2 is worded. Right. It talks about zoning, but it also says designation there as well. So keep that in mind. It's not just talking
about. But I've never seen a designation C.
Correct. And so that's why it poses an interesting question for you.
Okay. Just thought maybe you were going to have a clear answer for me. I always love these. Everything's just right here in the book.
I could have my own opinion, but I think for you, there's not a policy direction that I can cite.
Okay.
Well, and I have a question of staff in the Willa-Kinsey Area Plan in the unincorporated sub-area policies and proposed actions. It's actually on page 57 of the plan. Number one says, upon annexation, the city shall apply a GO general office zoning district to the 5-acre parcel designated for commercial use at the intersection of Coburg Road and County Farm Road. This site shall be limited to general office zoning. And I don't know if that's this parcel or an adjacent parcel.
That applies to a different property. That was clarified before the hearings official.
Okay, as that corner parcel. Yep. Okay, that's what I was kind of thinking, but I wasn't sure.
Yeah, the hearings official
wasn't sure.
Clarified that as well.
Okay.
This parcel?
I think it's that one, yeah.
that corner, yeah.
I'm not sure that, I'm not sure which property it is. I just know that it's not this one.
Not this one, okay.
Okay.
Other questions of staff? Commissioner Mills.
I'll ask a couple, and that is regarding to Wilkinsie Policy 2.2, where it says apply the site review suffix to all parcels zoned or designated for C1 and C2. Is that, in fact, what we've done? Are they C1 site review, C2 site review as currently zoned, or is this have... That's my first question.
I'm not sure I understand. You mean, have we done this in other places or here?
In Wilkinsie. In other words, is this instruction in the Wilkinsie, is this carried out in the zoning now, or has it been seen as no longer required? And I'm just trying to understand.
Well, that's, I think, one of the questions before you here is this relevant at this point? I mean, there's the two-part question here under Policy 2 is kind of the really the crux of the whole discussion. And that's, again, that's why some of the Benson piece, in our opinion, and the hearings official's opinion, came into play here, because there were some similar situations you dealt with in that site review discussion there. I think it's up to you to answer kind of whether or not you believe that the hearings official was correct in the way he interpreted it, which was to say that based on 2.1, he didn't believe that the code had been amended to satisfy the compatibility issues based on what you said in Benson, because your determination in Benson said essentially we disagree with previous hearings official decisions that made the statement in essence that the zone change required the application of site review. In those cases, the hearings official said it's not required because the code's been amended to address compatibility issues. You took issue with that in your Benson decision and said we don't believe that compatibility issues were satisfactorily addressed at the time of the multifamily standards being adopted. So the question for you now is, do you feel the same way with the commercial standards? Do you follow that?
Mm-hmm. I follow it, but I don't agree with what you just said. I don't.
Well, I can read to you what you said in Benson, if that helps. What you said in your discussion was. Let's see. Start here. Planning Commission.
Steve, were you reading?
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, this is on an attachment of the AIS, the last page of your, or second last page of your AIS.
Mm. Okay.
Okay, page
50.
The second paragraph, big paragraph there.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
This one or that one? In fact, maybe all of you should just read that whole paragraph, because I think that's to me is an important one, just to give you, to remind you of kind of what you said in Benson, and that may help determine how applicable you believe that is to this case.
What page are you on?
I'm sorry, page 50, second paragraph, the big paragraph here.
Page 50?
Of the AIS.
Of the AIS.
CC, page 50.
Okay.
Can I suggest we finish doing all the rest and do that during our read period?
Oh, okay.
Probably, sure. I think that's good. Any other questions of staff at this point? Commissioner Baker.
Yeah, on the map, the parcel south of County Farm Road at Coburn Road, it's zone C2/SR. Was that done in response to this policy, 2.2?
It is.
Pardon?
The basis for the site review to the south, whether that's in the record or not.
It must be. I read it. Can I speak to what I read? Remember reading?
Sure.
Yeah. I remember reading that it was done on the request of the applicant at the time.
Oh.
It was not asked. The city did not require it.
Okay. Yeah, I think that was on all of the ones that had
site review. Right.
I read that.
Okay. I have one more question, I guess. Are there... I don't know how to ask this and if staff has this at your fingertips or not, but are there GO standards that are unique, let me rephrase that. Are there site review standards that are unique to site review that are not part of the GO standards or requirements in the code? Did that make sense? We heard testimony about, you know, that the code pretty much has taken care of a lot of that. And I guess I'm just wondering the differences between what's required in site review and what would be required in the GO zone, if that's something you can answer for us, or if we need
to. I don't know if that's as much a factual thing to answer as it is something for you to look at, because that is one of the points you made in your findings with Benson, is making that distinction, and that's somewhat a matter of interpretation.
Okay.
So I think that's something you should look at, though, and to see what those standards are, the site review standards, and how they mesh. In Benson, you felt there was a gap. That was one of the reasons you imposed site reviews. You felt there were additional pieces of site review that were not addressed in the multifamily standards.
Yeah, that's a multifamily and commercial.
Right, so that's the question here is, do you feel the same way with the commercial standards?
Okay. Seeing no more questions of staff, how do we want to proceed? Do we want to take a short period of time to look at the additional testimony that came before us and then maybe reconvene, maybe take a short recess to do that?
And I think a 10-minute break till 7. It's 7:20. Reconvene at 7:30.
Geez, I already read them.
Well, you can stretch your legs.
John came early and read. Actually, I would say, is 7:30 enough? Too much time? Okay. So let's
if we get done, we can come back sooner.
If we're ready to start sooner, we can start sooner, but let's start. We'll take a brief break to review that testimony and reconvene at 7:30.
Yeah. Might be a 3
o'clock. It might be 7:25. So, you know, I just, okay.
I'm going to go find a break.
Yes, I
think that's a stretch.
something like, are we, Commissioner Duncan was still reading?
Yeah, because I had to take it.
More minutes?
No, go ahead.
Okay. Well, I think what I'll do then is we'll go ahead and reconvene, I guess, from our recess. And having had the chance to look through the testimony that was submitted to us tonight, what I wanted to do is maybe kind of revisit some of the questions that are before us. And as far as starting deliberations tonight and maybe completing deliberations tonight, you know, again, a sense from the commission on some of the policies, or you want to just go start down the policies, whether we think they're mandatory or not? Commissioner Jaworski.
I was going to ask, which did you want to do, a sense of what, or just the policies, or a walkthrough of?
Maybe just briefly, just in a minute or two, just give me what you're thinking.
Let me begin by saying this, that I read the referenced cases. I don't necessarily see how they're essential to what we're talking about, because they deal with specific uses. And I'm sure, like the hearing official, we consider all variables and we look at everything to that particular site or that particular issue that's coming up when we make a decision. And as already has been stated, some of them were with multi-unit housing, et cetera, residential, and they don't really relate to this particular situation. So I see this as a standalone. Let me begin by looking at, as of my thought process, I looked at policy one, and it just said on page 15, the city shall use the land use document and accompanying text, that's very important, to provide policy direction for public decisions affecting the planned area. Well, when one looks at page 19 plus, which is that map, you'll notice that the area that we're talking about.
Commissioner, what document are you referring to on these pages?
I'm looking at the Willackenzie area plan, but they're the same policies that are in yours. Okay, just for the record, in the Willackenzie plan map, at that what it has is. It has the intersection of Kohlberg and County Farm Road zoned as commercial. That commercial also includes the southern area, but also the site in question. So it's zoned commercial. That's number one. It also is noted, and I want you to note, if you looked at this map, immediately to the south and to the west, there's a B opportunity zone. And that can come into play later, because it's affected area when we look at what's happening there. And the B opportunity zone could be mixed use, residential, whatever. So that's also right in the immediate area that we're talking about and is in the Willackenzie plan. Additionally, on page 13 of the Willackenzie plan 1D, it talks and references the same area, and it refers to it as neighborhood commercial. Okay, the terms used then, rather than maybe C1 or whatever, but neighborhood commercial. And the intent was to serve small, localized neighborhood areas, because there's residential all around that. So those two things, when I look at that first policy, I think that that's pretty important that we take a look at that, because I'll refer later to the accompanying text, which is in that particular map. Additionally, if moving along, we
Commissioner Jaworski, I was thinking of just getting kind of a brief overview of where we were.
Well, I think if we want to put things in the record, they need to be explicit. Let me just say this. I'll jump to the end. I'm looking at this as a zoning change. I'm looking at what everything is reflected in the WAP that addresses zoning changes. I can jump to the end, which would have been a long way down. If you go to page 59 in the plan, and it's kind of interesting that it wasn't specifically referenced, but except as policy 10, it's a policy, says, the city shall recognize the existing neighborhood commercial zoning at the northwest corner of County Farm Road and Kohlberg Road and shall discourage any future commercial rezoning in this area. Okay? So I don't know how it got this far without being discouraged. Implying a site overlay isn't discouraging it. I think we're leaning backwards and allowing it to happen and be rezoned, but we're just saying let's have the site review, which is something that will involve everyone to consider what's going to happen there. Also, in reading all the other testimony, that's a use issue, and we're looking at a zoning change and not a use issue. So that's as brief as I can get. I'll fill in the later when we have more.
Okay. And I'll jump in because I'm thinking we'll just go down the line, but I do want to keep our comments brief at this stage of it. And I guess I see some distinctions on this between Benson and this, because Benson was residential, this is commercial. I think my concern with the general policies is that it does specifically talk about applying the site review to C1 and C2, but doesn't mention GO. And GO was in existence at that time. It's even in the Willikensee Area Plan, too. I think where I'm struggling the most with just outright taking off the site review is that the city, the North Region Unincorporated Subarea Policy 2, that the city shall require future developments on parcels abutting the UGB to provide an effective transition between urban and rural land uses and to minimize the potential conflicts. And I think where I'm trying to decide is, in my mind, does going from C1 with no site review, going to GO, either with or without site review, does GO alone, is that enough of a transition? Are there enough protections in the GO zone, which is kind of why I brought that up earlier, to provide adequate transition? And it does say even the purpose of the GO zone is to provide a transition. That's where I'm kind of struggling with this. So that's kind of where I'm at. Commissioner Baker.
Yeah, my concerns, and I'm reassured that at least to know that there was GO zones in the area when they wrote this, but there's policy 2, and then there's they wrote some actions, but policy 2 states shall ensure that future commercial development and redevelopment in the Willikensee area is sensitive to and compatible with existing and planned development in the area, in the surrounding area. And then they talk about applying, the two actions are essentially, the second action is the SR overlay requirement specifically for C1 or C2. However, when I go back and look at the site review criteria, there's an issue here with compatibility with the surroundings, particularly when residential in character, which is somewhat that concern you mentioned about the UGB expansion, where it's unclear what that would be, although I'm not certain how we're supposed to interpret that. A number of the other criteria might very well have been partially met by changes in the code. I'd really have to go through and check, do a checklist and compare, but my general feeling is the code changes in the past weren't complete panacea. Otherwise, why are we doing an elaborate Willamette area plan, for example, with all kinds of transition issues trying to resolve them? And that's, I think, because we don't really have the ideal fix in the code currently for transition issues between zones. Okay. So that's my while I would be very supportive of the use, even though we're not supposed to be considering that, one concern that I have is we don't adopt a policy that sort of forces us to consider future issues in light of another decision we made here regarding, I mean, when I look at this map, I see other property that could very well come in to the city boundary, with a commercial zone of some kind. I just don't want to preclude situations where there may be an issue where commercial is coming in adjacent to residential, and we've sort of removed that potential concern.
Okay. Commissioner Mills.
I can start by saying I'm generally supportive of what's been said by Commissioners Jaworski, Randall, and Baker. I'll make a couple of fairly broad statements. One is that the worthiness of the current potential sale is remarkable, but what we have to deal with is the zone, And in my mind, that means I'm going to change this to ZO. This deal's going to fall through on what could be built there. And how do I protect the neighborhood in that way? So as worthy as it is, I'm looking at zone. I'm also still struggling with the applicability of the Benson decision for a number of reasons, some of which I've already mentioned, some of which have to do with, as you've mentioned already, Commissioner Randall. I'm also trying to make sure that I give sufficient weight to the intent of the Willikinsey area plan and where it applies. And that's all I'll say for now.
Okay. Commissioner Borofsky.
I would say I'm leading for removing site review from this. If we can do that tonight, I think that would be the way to go. I think that it would be defendable that our action in Benson was based on different zones and different criteria. So I don't see that being a problem. And I also am swayed by, Boffman?
Mm-hmm.
I think that gets to policy two fairly clearly for me as far as being commercial, and that the fact that it was intended to do what it said, have the city come up with policies that would address the site review, and I think that that's what happened in 2001 or 2002 when the new codes were enacted. And what was represented in the testimony tonight was that the site review would do nothing to change the way this was built out. It would just add time. And I think that's why those code changes were made. At least I would hope that's why some of them were made. So that's the direction that I'm leaning. Can support those later on if need be.
Commissioner Duncan.
Well, as Mr. Close liked to point out, I guess I've been here a long time when we're discussing all the cases I made decisions on. I think I've been around too long, maybe. I mean, for me, BOFTA was back far enough that I remember a lot of that discussion, and we really did deal with 2-2 as it was commercial and multifamily. For me, Benson, and what I remember of it, really relied more on page 16 of the Willikinsey Refinement Plan, and it had to do with 8A, and it says, apply a site review suffix to all parcels designated multi or high-density residential land use which directly abut low-density residential use. To me, that was real clear. In this case, I think that policy 2-2 really talks about an SR overlay for parcels zoned C1, C2. I could suggest that GO might be in there because it tends to be commercial. But it goes beyond that and says, for development within the Willikinsey plan, using the Willikinsey commercial siting and development guidelines as review criteria. These guidelines will be used to evaluate commercial development and redevelopment proposals until such time as the city adopts citywide commercial development standards and guidelines, which I'm going to suggest is the document that Becky gave us earlier tonight, which is 9.2100 and on. So to me, the first case really dealt with commercial and multifamily. The second case really dealt with LDR land or low density and low density residential and medium density. In this case, goes back to dealing with commercial lands and so on. And actually, I'm going to, just as a side, because I took, as Commissioner Jaworski suggested, number 59, when he referred to number 10 as being to discourage any future commercial rezoning of the area. I would agree, but the subject property is already zoned commercial, so in my mind, this policy is saying the subject in the parcel next door to the east and below that on the south is our commercial nub there, and that's all we want there. And so for me, 10 actually supports the idea of leaving this sort of commercial sort of development in that area the way it is. And to me, GO again fits in with commercial zones. So for me, I was a little surprised when I read the hearings officer decision that leaned back so much on Benson and sort of said, gee, I wouldn't have done it other than Benson comes into play. And to me, Benson was completely a different decision with completely different reasons why we applied the SR there. And so from my standpoint, this was fairly clear to me as I read through this that I would support removal of the site review.
Commissioner Jaworski.
Yeah, since I brought up page 59, I'll just say, Commissioner Duncan, if that's your conclusion, then there was no need for them to apply for a rezoning the way you're stating it. And this is an application for rezoning. So I can't agree with what you're saying.
That's fine.
They're the same. Secondly, in regard to 2.2, if you look at 2.1, it says a city, and maybe that's what it directs, ensure future development, be sensitive to. And then you look at their action items, and you say, well, you know, they amend the Eugene Code to be compatible and reflect recommendations in the whole Willackenzie plan, not just singular little ones, but the whole plan. And secondly, 2.2 says apply to SR review to all parcels designated C1, this and that. Well, they didn't do that. And apparently, if they didn't do that, it suggested that their commercial development standards they felt were adequate. Well, if that's the case, staff wouldn't have recommended to them that they apply it in this case, because they are the city, as far as I'm concerned. So if the city recommended to the hearing official that it should add a site over review, then it feels that in order to meet policy 2, it hasn't done enough, and it's doing that. Okay. To ensure compatibility.
I think the first question we really need to hit is, do we feel that the hearings officials, do we agree with the hearings official that these policies are mandatory in this case? Because I think that'll help us walk through the next steps as far as the assignments of error and whether we go from there. And I'm kind of hearing, I think, at least from some commissioners, and I know from my standpoint, is I don't think they are mandatory because they don't, it's different than Benson, and that I think it is mandatory to apply the site review suffix to C1 and C2, but I see that different than GO. And the site review procedures under 5, the way I see it anyway, shall be considered for properties. And from my perspective, I don't see that it's mandatory. But I'm open to what your thoughts are, Commissioner Mills.
I guess I'm struggling with the idea that GO is kinder and gentler. I think in some cases it is, and some cases it is not. And that's where, you know, the use it's contemplated for it is certainly a gentler use. But if we're looking at the zone and what the potential spectrum is, building height, for example, has been brought up. It's not in all cases. To me, it's as I look down the table, it looks to me more like a wash. One is more heavily weighted towards commercial retail. The other is more heavily weighted towards employment. So, to me, that's another premise I struggle with. That one is kinder and gentler than the other.
Which is kind of the second part of what I think we're going to need to get to, as far as do we feel the hearings official was correct or not on saying it was mandatory, and then from there we can decide if site review is the appropriate way to address that. Commissioner Borofsky.
Well, for me, I mean, the sentence that sticks out in the hearings official decision is, if the Planning Commission had not reversed the hearings official position on the Benson case, I might well agree with the applicant and the prior hearings official that the site review overlay should not be applied. So, for me, it doesn't come down to is Section 2 applicable. I think if we're looking at errors and remanding it back, if that's the way that we go, he got that wrong because he didn't read, in my view, he didn't read our intent of Benson and our reading of Benson and the policies that we used out of the WAP to make Benson's site review overlay. We used policy 8, and we had nothing to do with policy 2. So for me, if he was basing that site, applying that site review on there, on our decision, then and he wouldn't have done it without, then that's an error on his part. And I can support findings that would support that, if that's the way, you know, I think
which,
that's clear.
Which is the first assignment of
exactly.
Error.
Exactly. Yeah. And so for me, that's what I'm looking at, is this, okay. The assignments of error in front of us.
Just to make sure, as you talk about this, kind of clear that the decision whether it's mandatory or not, you can conclude that the policies are mandatory and still conclude that site review doesn't need to be applied. You don't need, in case you're thinking in this way, I'm not sure if that's where you were going, that in order to reverse the decision, you need to make a determination that the policies are not mandatory. That's not as critical as how you read the policy. So you can agree, I mean, you could determine they are mandatory, but as I read them, I don't believe that site review should be applied for various reasons. And I've heard a few around the table of different reasoning. Even if it is mandatory, you don't believe that it necessarily would be applied. That's perfectly fine to go that route. I think if you're going to deal with the mandatory question, you do need to look at the language that's part of that, and that's what the hearings official cited. And that shouldn't necessarily take you down one path or another necessarily. You still have the freedom to decide, okay, even if it's mandatory, how do we read these policies and how do they apply or not to this particular case? You can still have the freedom to decide. Does that make sense?
I think so. I guess I'm starting to wonder if, rather than deciding whether it's mandatory or not, if we started just going through the assignments of error.
Right. I heard most folks leaping over that and kind of going into, well, even if it is, here's how I feel about it. And
yeah.
So I think it might be easier at this point, since you've already started that discussion, just to keep going and deal with that question.
Okay. Does that seem like a reasonable way to approach it? Okay. So the first assignment of error states the hearings official erred in making a decision based on his guess about what the Planning Commission might decide about site review for this application, based on what it did in the Benson decision, rather than relying on his own reading of the law that applies. The Commission should remand this decision to the hearings official with the direction to make a decision based on his own reading of the law. Commissioner Jaworski.
Yeah, and it's a good follow-up what Commissioner Borowski just said. You know, when we hear these arguments of shall and must, and if it's shall followed by another word, then it's not mandatory. If it's by itself, it gets kind of confusing. So I also feel the same way. When a hearing official says, I might, that doesn't mean he will. So I just think that might is also stretching it to say he was going to go in that direction. Secondly, if you read what the hearing official said on page 4, he said the code amendments in themselves are not enough to ensure that policy 2 is satisfied. And according to the city, the GO zoning to ensure proper development of the site itself, but not specifically ensure compatibility with existing and planned development in the surrounding areas. So he is considering other factors when he's saying that. And he also points to the additional reasonings for requiring a site overlay, which is policy 5, which he interprets, which is enough to show what the intent of what the Willa-Kenzie area plan was starting to say. So I kind of feel that he did not base his decision on any guess. There were other factors that he considered, although he did say something about one of them, only because it was interjected into the discussion.
Other comments? I guess I'll jump in and say that I think, you know, the hearings official saying that I might well agree, and that had we not reversed his position on site review in Benson, I think it's apples and oranges. And so I think in that instance, I would say that the hearings official did err in that particular aspect of it. And that's not to say whether site review should or shouldn't be applied, but I just feel that that's one that the hearings official erred on. Commissioner Mills.
I'm feeling like his whole decision is polluted by that qualification he's made for his decision. I mean, and in that sense, I would view it as an error. It invalidates the decision, in my view, because he's you know, I might well agree with the applicant and prior hearings officials that the site review should not have applied. You know, I might, as you said. You know, to me, that just throws it into the wind.
Which gets us back to that mandatory approval criteria, because he then goes on to say that he agrees with staff that site review overlay is necessary to ensure compliance with the mandatory approval criteria. And so that gets us back to that question of whether we feel that those criteria are mandatory. Commissioner Brofsky.
I agree. I think he's erred for the reasons that were brought up, one of the, which we haven't put on the table yet, is, but was brought up by Mr. Close about the fact that it should be each thing should have its own hearing, you know, not, but then you can bring, I guess you can bring in other things. And then the part about the he refers to Benson as a reason to do it and discounts Botham as because of Benson. And Botham, to me, is very clear on the exact policy that is in question. Question two.
Just to be clear, he didn't have Botham in front of him. That just so you realize, it hadn't been brought to his attention.
Botham has.
It wasn't in the record.
So when he says...
He's talking about Welch.
Oh, he's talking about Welch. Okay. Well, and that comes into play as well, too, in my opinion. I think the Welch voice decision comes into play as well as in favor of not having the site review overlay. So.
Mr. Baker?
Yeah, I have to... I tend to agree with Commissioner Jaworski that in his discussion he talks about policy two, code amendments are not in themselves enough to ensure that policy two is satisfied. For me, my concern is policy two is critical to me, and then we had some proposed actions underneath it, but policy two is the one that says shall ensure, blah, 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 that future. And then, you know, these are some proposed actions that were put in place to, I guess, first one is so general that it's not really helpful. And the second one is very specific. But so to me, you can still disagree with the decision, but whether he erred, whether it was mandatory, that I can't completely disagree with because of policy two and the wording in his discussion where he talks about, you know, there's policy two and policy five, site review are required, shall be considered for properties which abut or face one another when the use is permitted and those properties are potentially incompatible. I mean, you know, what do we mean by different uses, in other words, and where you have this urban growth boundary that could expand to, if you look at the map, you see residential here. So it doesn't mean that you might find issue with it in other ways, but I think policy two still is mandatory that we make sure the development is compatible, and then whether the SR is the proper way to do that. In this case, it's just the way we decided in Benson. In that case, we decided that SR was the proper way to guarantee that in that specific case because we had the uses in mind, but I'm not sure about this one.
So if we look at that first assignment of error and separate out Benson and whether or not it's mandatory.
Right. I think that's a better way to do it.
Are we able to go there? Because what I'm hearing is that there's a sense among the commission, not to put words in your mouths, that we feel that the hearings official erred by using Benson as an example, but that there's maybe still some discussion about whether or not it is mandatory on the policies. Commissioner Borofsky.
Yeah, and I mean, I think another thing to look at is on page 23 of our AIS, at the very top, it's referring to the Welch brothers, and it says several, and this is from staff, in changing it from R3 to GO and to remove the site review overlays from a GO existing zone, several changes have occurred to the Eugene City Code since 1998 that have eliminated the need for site review to address issues of compatibility. Then it goes on, the Eugene Code has been updated to include development standards that specifically address the scale, bulk, building, and parking coverages of commercial developments. So the city cited that in a zone change from GO to remove the site overlay in a different case, and it was upheld. So the city earlier on said it's covered. Site review doesn't, all of the criteria that site review would do is covered, and that was in the Welch brothers, which was in front of the hearings official. So,
Mr. Mills.
I guess I'm going to bring up the counterpoint to that. Attachment C, page 4, last sentence. According to the city, this is the decision.
Page 4,
attachment C, last sentence, beginning according to the city. Development, the development standards for geo zoning ensure proper development of the site itself, but do not specifically ensure compatibility with existing and planned development in the surrounding area. This being the case the city is making today, or at this time, for site review. So, I mean, there's pointing out that that's here also. So.
Right.
So, do we agree that the hearings official erred by citing Benson as an example?
Yes.
Okay.
Let me understand that. Personally, I can agree that by referencing Benson, he made a mistake, but I can't agree that he erred in his decision in total.
And I'm not asking that.
No, well, yeah.
That's what the first assignment of error is saying.
But we're breaking it into two parts.
I'm kind of with you too, John, on that. There's two questions here.
Okay, you're breaking it into two parts.
So the question is if the hearings official erred by making a decision based on his guess about what the Planning Commission might decide about site review for this application based on what it did in the Benson decision. So that's that first sentence.
For me to support that, I would say that he erred in utilizing Benson as part of his decision-making process. Because he made a decision based on his guess. That's saying that's the only thing he did, and I don't agree with that. And I can agree with Benson saying he shouldn't have referenced
And I believe we're just asking that one question.
That one part of that.
Regarding Benson.
Okay.
Is there a thumbs up that the hearings official erred in that? In using Benson, okay.
Or it's not using Benson.
Depending
on Benson, right? So I mean, you know, if you want to, or relying.
Depending. Yeah, I feel it was just part of what he looked at.
Right.
That part he shouldn't have looked at. I mean, it wasn't relevant.
What he said is, if the Planning Commission had not reversed the hearings official's position on site review in the Benson case, I might well agree with the applicant and prior hearings officials that the site review overlay should not be applied. And the question is if he erred by referencing Benson in that instance for that portion of the decision.
And then I guess the next step of that is what was the city's other reasoning for putting site review on there? If it wasn't for Benson, what is the other justification for site review that was presented to the hearings
official? They've been cited. I think those have been cited. I think Commissioner Mills cited it. I cited one section that indicates that it doesn't fully address compatibility. I think in his decision he cites that, and then he goes, I don't agree with him that it's not an approval criteria on this one thing where it says or the other, but he also says it's sufficient enough to be used. And if you look at
if you look at two, which we policy two, it says the city will do this. Well, the city to ensure that, so they can do anything. And what they recommended was site review overlay. So I think they're following through with the policy and doing it. So that's part of the consideration. I just want to make sure that I don't vote on something that we're dividing in two if it's not worded correctly, because he never used the word, I guess I will do this. He said, I might, you know, and it's not written. Do you hear it making a decision based on what might be, you know? It says guess, and I don't like reacting to something that I don't agree with and saying, yes, that's correct.
Mr. Baker.
I almost feel that the first, you know, issue on appeal is really not, it's really the other ones that are the crucial ones, not the first one. Mm-hmm. I mean, in other words, if we read through it, if WAP policy 2 is an approval criteria, okay. Blah, blah, you know, in other words, this is more about speculation and
okay. And we do have to address each
right.
Assignment
well,
of error.
I mean, I think you'll be addressing the first assignment error by the time you really get to the substance and meat of the right. Second one is.
If you jump to three, I think you're going to get one captured as part of that.
Right, that's my thinking. Okay. You know, if we come to consensus on 2, 3, and 4, then we'll have decided on one, and okay. Or what you know.
So jump to three.
Well, so yeah, I mean, what I heard at least so far, and we can come back as needed to that, was really kind of more keeping it pretty distinct that the hearing official erred by relying on Benson. Now, there's more to whether site review should be applied or not that you're going to get to, but at least in terms of one, it seemed to me that seemed to be the center point of what I was hearing. Is that fair?
Because three, it seems like if we start with three,
right. Yeah. It's
that'll
question
hit whether it's mandatory others. Or not and whether, okay.
Right.
So third assignment of error. Having agreed with the applicant that the SR applicability provisions of EC 9.4410 say that SR may be applied if it is required by a refinement plan, the hearings official erred in applying the SR while also finding that there is nothing in the WAP that specifically requires the imposition of the site review overlay. But do we feel the hearings official correctly interpreted that or not? I think so. Okay, Commissioner Borofsky. Anyone else?
Well, I think there's plenty of language in the WAP that leads you towards a site review.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think there's two issues here. One in this case is the policy 2 by itself and 2.1, which would allow you to apply site review. And then the question is, how do we interpret 2.2 in this specific case? The 2 and 2.1 would certainly allow the city to apply site review to a GO zone based upon the WAP.
And I think my concern with that is I don't see that it says that you must do that. You can, but not that you must. And it specifically in 2.2 talks about C1 and C2, not GO. Yeah. Commissioner Jaworski.
Again, 2.1 and 2.2 are action items just to clarify the policy. The policy says the city shall ensure that its planned development in the surrounding area is compatible with. So that's just two ways they could ensure it. There are other ways. And if they felt it wasn't insured, that's why they recommended we should apply the site review overlay. I really strongly feel that the way that it's read in here.
But you could make the case that 2.1 has been done.
Because they amended the code mm-hmm. to include more protection.
Right. That's how I read it.
Well, but it says to amend the code to ensure, so the city may feel that even though the code was amended, it didn't ensure compatibility, which is why when the hearing official said the GO zone does not go outside the site and ensure compatibility with surrounding areas.
That's what we're deciding
right.
here,
right.
is whether we feel that the GO zone provides adequate or ensures adequate compatibility.
And I keep going back to staff's position at the hearing where they say that it should be done. You know, so to me, I'm inferring from that they don't feel like the code as it currently exists is sufficient.
Well, I was at the hearing. I was the staff at the hearing. So I'll just tell you how I thought about it, if it helps you.
Yes.
So policy 2 and 2.1 and 2.2 in previous cases, we had determined to remove the site review overlay because we felt that the code had addressed that policy. So that's what the Welch Boys case is that's referenced in the packet. And we had this long-running history of just even stripping site review overlay and not imposing site review overlay because it was a placeholder until we had code amendments. Then in Benson, if you look at the 8, so just to show you how much Benson played into our thought process, if you look at Benson, it has similar language, but it's different enough. And I think that's the decision that we want you to make. Is so out of respect for the Planning Commission's determination in Benson about compatibility not being addressed by code standards, that you couldn't just automatically, when you're considering site review in that kind of policy direction, you can't just assume that the code fixes it, that there could be something else to look at that would warrant site review. And so that's why it was an important case in how we read policy 2.
So I think if I can just piggyback quickly on that, so if you feel there are some distinctions between the Benson case and this in that manner, for instance, I heard a couple of you say you feel that the commercial standards, the GO standards, do address compatibility. Maybe you didn't determine that with the multifamily, but you do here. That's totally within your purview to conclude that. I think what you saw before you with the decisions was trying to respect the decision you made before to say we don't believe that they were for multifamily. It's hard to tell where you would land with commercial in that same question. And that's why you have the answers in front of you the way you do, because part of that's reflecting your previous decision.
Okay. I've got Commissioner Borofsky first.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Because to me, that helps. Not only did the hearings official rely on Benson, staff, the city, as Commissioner Jaworski is representing it, also relied on our decision in Benson. So to me, what that says to me is, one, our findings were not clear enough in Benson. They should have been more prescriptive or, you know, more
precise to that.
More sustenance that it was dealing with policy 8 in the WAP and not the commercial. Not, it doesn't go to all policies in the WAP as far as our decision at imposing site review. So for me, that makes it even clearer that not only did the hearings official refer to our decision in Benson, staff was using that, and staff previous to the Benson case, they would not have imposed site review because they felt that it was captured in the code. So for me, they're doing kind of what is done in the medical field, is we're going to cover our ass and ask for 5 tests because somebody might come back on it. So I think that helps me even more makes it even more clear.
Baker, Mills, and then Jaworski.
Okay. I just want to make a point that I'm quite familiar with the GO zone because we have it in our neighborhood, and I can assure you it does not deal with compatibility from my point of view in a number of areas. Now, obviously, some changes that were made in the code fixed transportation and egress, but in terms of transitions between zones, adequate parking, when you have multiple uses, there are a significant number of problems in this GO zone as implemented in my neighborhood. So I can't say that the code change that was done in 2000 and whatever solved those problems, because I know that on the ground that is not the case. So I just keep hearing this over and over again, that, you know, that that may not be the case, a problem in this particular instance, but I can't say that the code changes that were made in 2001 resolve the need for never applying the SR zone in the Willa-Kenzie area. I just want to make that clear. That doesn't mean that when we come to three, that so again, my concern with the refinement plan is policy two, and then we have these proposed actions. The question is whether is site review is required by the refinement plan in this particular case.
Mr. Mills.
Can I?
Oh, sure.
I'm going to have to leave, so I wanted to just let people know that. I wanted to point out whether it's required by refinement plan. I mean, that's what you should really be focusing on, whether site review is required by the refinement plan. You're going to get into all those issues, but I would, now that we've talked about circles, but I would really focus in on what Commissioner Baker just said. But I will be available the next 4 or 5 days to answer questions. So if before you wrap up tonight you have a list of legal questions that you want me to answer, I can certainly do that. So I guess I'll just leave that.
Thank you, Ann. Commissioner Mills.
Yeah, just a follow-up question to staff. Thank you for the additional information regarding your concerns around Benson and honoring what we were trying to do. Beyond that concern for Benson, were there other reasons why you felt that site review was needed?
There were two other policies that we looked at.
Okay.
And as a package, there seemed to be support for site review, but in my mind, it was really your decision on Benson that kind of changed things for how we looked at those policies and the importance of site review compared to the code standards that have been adopted since the Willa-Kenzie area plan. The site review as a placeholder for the code amendments. Benson changed our thinking. Okay. Could be something more.
Thank you.
Commissioner Jaworski.
Well, I guess the hearing official might have got a lot of things wrong. It says the city also references WAP policy 5, WAP policy 2, WAP policy 10, and he also quotes and said it three times, according to the city, the development standards for GEO don't ensure blah, blah, blah. Where did he get that if he didn't say that? GEO doesn't ensure compatibility with existing plant outside in the surrounding area, which I believe what the WAC is trying to address. It's not looking at site-specific. It didn't even have sites up in this particular area or most of the northern part of that area. Did the city not say that the GO doesn't do that, or was he wrong there in what he wrote? In his mind?
Well, again, I think this comes full circle back to you to determine that, and we've told you that part of the basis for our recommendation to the hearing official was based on the Benson case, and specifically around the adequacy of the GO zone versus the site review question that you grapple with in Benson. So that is something he's relating to as well as part of that decision when he says the city. So you're back to that same question again. If you believe there's distinctions here, that's what's really the important question. If you feel that the GEO standards address that question in 2.1, then I think you pretty much are answering a lot of the other questions that fall from that. I think the other policies that came into place were more supportive of that, but really the crux of the decision is based in the general policy 2.
The other part I had is for a legal question since she left is I'm still unclear on number 10, and I really want to know, is the GO zone a commercial zone and therefore not considered a rezoning, or is that a rezoning?
We have that decision in the hearings officials on policy 10. that was addressed by the hearing official.
GO is commercial.
GO is a commercial zone.
I know, but is it considered rezoning to go from C1 to GO?
Well, it's one commercial zone to another commercial zone.
So it's still a rezoning.
Okay. Yeah. I just wanted that to be in the minutes.
On third assignment of error, do we feel that the site review is required by the refinement plan because there isn't enough protections in the GO zone?
Well, no, that's
too much.
That's the other that's because the other part was the wrong.
Okay. And so on third assignment of error.
Let me try this one for you. If you believe that section 2.1 has been satisfied by the adoption of the commercial design standards for the GO, do you then believe that it is still required or not? So I guess there's kind of a two-part piece to that. If you believe those commercial design standards were adopted to deal with compatibility, then you may conclude that policy has been satisfied, therefore site review is not required. Does that make sense?
And I think
2.1 or 2.2?
I think let's take them individually.
And I think that, in my opinion, 2.1 is satisfied by the new code language, and that is enforced by the Welsh Boys decision.
Mm-hmm.
Agreed. Okay. Agreed. Commissioner Mills?
I don't know.
Okay.
I'm going to have to spend some time studying GO.
Okay. Commissioner Baker?
Yeah, I if I were looking generally at this, I'd say I don't think so. I don't know. I mean, I'd have to compare. But I know the GO zone doesn't have any transition criteria between zones, whereas some of the other zones do, so.
And Commissioner Jaworski, I'm sensing you don't believe it does.
The GO doesn't satisfy the compatibility requirement.
Okay. And I believe it does. Commissioner Duncan.
Well, maybe, I mean, again, I'm looking at this colored map and thinking about compatibility with surrounding properties, and not to try to throw a monkey wrench in here, but the surrounding properties are commercial, multifamily, and commercial on three of the sides. And I'm not sure what we do to make them compatible with commercial uses or multifamily. On the sort of north and north west of the parcel is agricultural land, which is under a farming operation, which to me is a production process to generate crops and so on. And I don't know why I would worry about necessarily being compatible with a farming operation if I'm building buildings and so on. I mean, I don't know that what I do on my property affects a farming operation negatively. So, I mean, to a certain extent, the surrounding uses, which is what 2 sort of refers to, is really surrounding land uses, and surrounding land uses are generally commercial uses. Now, some of them I agree is AGUL because they haven't They haven't annexed and gone for zone change, but the plan designations are for multifamily and commercial uses surrounding it, except again for the agricultural, which is in production, and I don't know the zoning on it, but you've got to believe it's some sort of ag zoning, which isn't going to be developed into housing or anything else. It's going to stay a farm use. And I'm not sure when we're outside the area or outside the UGB in the city limits, are we so concerned about compatibility when it'd be one thing if these were houses over there or rural residential, but as production land, it's in reality an industrial type use. So, I mean, if we're concerned about compatibility of surrounding uses, it's basically all the same uses. So I don't know how you change that compatibility and make it something different. So again, everything to me leads to me that I don't believe there's a need for site review on this property.
Yes. And and we've got a split decision on 2.1. Yeah. I had Commissioner Borofsky first, then Commissioner Baker.
And to piggyback on that, in reading the site review standards, I don't see anything in site review that would do more for compatibility that isn't already in the code. If somebody at the table can cite something in the site review standards that would make this a more compatible site, then perhaps I might lean towards that. But I don't think there's anything in there that site review is going to do except for add time and money to this process. It's not going to make it more compatible. So why would we do it? I mean, and that comes down to let's do what's right for, you know, whether it's something out of a 22-year-old refinement plan or something that's putting a shovel in the ground that is correct, I would lean towards the latter.
Mr. Baker.
Well, I just wonder, again, I'm not to be the devil's advocate here or whatever, but number one, under site review sub-district initiation, compatibility with surroundings, particularly when residential in character, this factor shall not take precedence over the need to provide housing for all income groups in the city.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear what you said.
9.688A(b)(1). If you just read that on page 9-218 in the 96 code, number one is the case where we don't currently deal with that because we don't have any transition standards between GO and
residential.
And, you know,
and
again,
I'll go right back to the purpose of the GO general office zone in 9.2140. That it's designed to implement the metro plan by providing areas that allow a compatible mix of office and residential development. The zone is intended to provide for small to medium-sized office buildings, often in transitional locations between residential and commercial uses. Developments shall be compatible with nearby residential uses in terms of scale, bulk, building and parking coverage, traffic generation, and other external factors. And I think it's there.
Just to get in there, I have no problem. It's a transition zone between R3 and commercial, but it's not a transition zone between R1 and commercial. So,
but there's no R1 there.
Yeah, well, what happened? Well,
the plan designations are medium density residential and commercial.
Okay, right? So this is going to be R2 or R3.
It's going to be medium density residential. So yeah, I guess that would be R2
MDR
or R3
currently.
MDR. Well, we've got 3-2 to abstain.
Right. Yes, I want to amend what I've said, and that I felt like what has been stated, particularly by Commissioner Duncan, was enlightening to me, because having looked at the map and addressed the map, if the concerns are transition between GO and MDR, the only transition is across a road, as I see this map. So once again, we start getting into talking about, I have a concern here. I'm talking about this parcel and what's applicable to this parcel and how that might be construed by staff to be taken across the entire area. But given this parcel, the transition issues are less of a concern to me than they would be
Are you changing your I don't know vote?
Yes. I'm changing from a no to a yes in this case for this parcel.
So 2.1, we are 4-2 that we agree.
And again, to that note, in your findings, put in there that one of the considerations was the abutting land.
For this particular parcel.
The zoning on the abutting land helped sway the decision of the council, so that you know.
Commission. I'm going to move on because we're going late.
I was just going to say that I was comfortable with that, knowing that this is going to be MDR, and we're not concerned about UGB expansion, mm-hmm. which might be. I look over here and I see single family here, right? And I'm concerned about this becoming
Are you wanting to change your no vote to a yes?
Let's leave it. It passes anyway, so it doesn't really matter.
Just thought I'd ask. All right. 2.2, apply the site review suffix to all parcels zoned or designated C1 or C2. And
if you agree with 1, I think 2.1, then 2 becomes, 2.2 becomes moot.
Yeah. Right. Okay. And then policy 5. Site review procedures for special development standards shall be considered for properties which abut or face one another when the uses permitted on those properties are potentially incompatible. And it sounds like with 2.1, my feeling is we've addressed that also.
And just to remind you, too, the hearings official actually determined that was not a mandatory criterion, but he felt it helped support his findings on 2.1. So if you've already disagreed with that, it kind of weakens.
And I would agree that that one isn't mandatory since it says shall be considered, but moot point. Mr. Baker.
And I would make I would add to our remarks that that's because the adjacent properties are either commercial or multifamily.
Right. We have
or
that.
Ag.
Or ag. In other words, you know, we're not saying that this applies in all cases, but in this case, when there's no single family or other incompatible uses, that seems reasonable.
And then on North Region unincorporated subarea, item 2, again, it seems like 2.1, we've addressed that.
Well, I think some of the opinion that I heard from Commissioner Duncan kind of went a little deeper to the UGB question, which I think was helpful.
Of the ag lands.
And so it'd be good to get a sense from you about that, if you agree with those kinds of conclusions as well.
And I think that I read someplace in possibly the appellant's arguments that there is no transition anywhere written to mining and agricultural. There's no standards that are written anywhere in the code for that.
Right.
So to say that you have to apply transition standards to something that there are no standards in the code anywhere would be difficult.
Commissioner Duncan.
I might clarify. I think the hearings officer maybe misread the metro plan map, if that's where he got the sand and gravel aspect, because sand and gravel actually is further to the west.
Yeah,
it doesn't abut this property at all. It's all ag.
Okay. Check that just to make sure, but okay.
You know, there's some sand and gravel out in that general area.
Yeah.
Yeah, but if you look at the metro plan map, definitely shows these two bumps right here, and it's brown going down to here somewhere.
11 by 17.
It's the real one.
No, you got
it can only be 11 by 17.
I hope so.
Okay.
Actually,
Commissioner,
it's an old one.
Yeah, that's the one you got the other night.
Who knows where I got them from? I've been around for a while.
Also, okay. Not the 2004 bill, sorry.
But what is it? Is it older yet?
Yes.
Bill, you want it and frame it?
If it's a 2004, I want it in case the key.
Commissioner Baker.
So 97.
Yeah. So, again, we're talking about subarea policy 2. It seems to me that the way that was worded, too, it's more, I think it was really more applicable. The example would be you wouldn't want a hog farm next to a residential development, say, right directly. You know, you'd want a transition. So the transition is implied. It's more from the agriculture use to the urban
the other
use.
Way.
Yeah, the other way. The way I would interpret that normally.
Okay.
That's the way I interpreted that one. And it's just, it's also awkward to think about planning for something that we don't know what will happen here, whether this will stay agricultural land or it'll be whatever.
Right.
Okay. But to add to that, just to make sure, what I heard Commissioner Duncan also say was, you know, that the types of uses, if it was impacts outward to parcels outside the UGB, that the type of uses that you're basically trying to protect are less sensitive in that way. Is that what I heard?
Yes.
And I wondered if that there was consensus on that as well, because I think that would be an important piece to add.
Mm-hmm. I think I agree with that.
Okay. Others? I saw some nodding heads. Yeah, okay.
Okay. So then, having gotten to this point, are we amenable to whether or not removing site review?
I would move to remove site review.
Is there a second?
Second.
Further discussion?
Just speaking to the motion, I think that that would be the most, I mean, I think we're going to get there anyways. It would be my opinion if this gets referred back to the hearings official with our findings. I believe that he will, it would be my opinion that he would remove the site review.
We won't refer back if we make a decision.
No.
You don't need to. You
can make your decision. But what I'm saying, if we refer this back with our findings, I feel confident that he would remove site review. That's my opinion.
So your purpose in your motion is to just go ahead and do it here rather than refer it back.
Well, that's what I'm speaking to. It's my opinion, and the reason I made the motion was that it's in my opinion that if that goes back, if it goes back to the hearings official as we are doing with the assignment of errors, the outcome will be the same. So for me, rather than jumping through another hoop and going back, I think we can address the issue. I think in parcel specific here, we've looked at it and we feel that the transitions and everything are being taken care of through the code that's on the book, and site review would do nothing more to aid in those transitions. And so I think that moving forward with removing site review is the proper way to go about it.
We have a motion and a second. Commissioner Mills, I saw your hand.
Yeah, I just want to say that for me, a key element of how I'm going to vote is the disposition of the land around the parcels around this parcel in terms of applying, for lack of a better term, the fearful word common sense in this case, in that transitions are fairly easy given the uses that are adjacent, and that my vote is predicated upon the very specific location of this parcel.
And I would jump in and say basically the same thing, that it's not like this is next to low density residential. It is designated medium density, and I feel there's adequate provisions in the GO zone to provide those transitions and that protection without applying site review overlay. Commissioner Duncan.
And I would like, if the commission agrees, that type of discussion becomes very strong in this decision, so that maybe we don't have problems as we apparently created with the Benson decision, that I thought we were very clear on why we did it, because it was LDR versus MDR. Apparently we weren't that clear about it, so I'd like to make sure that the findings of this, if we go ahead and support this, is very clear that it's site specific. It can be used later on if it's similar to other sites, but that way we wouldn't have a confusion of this one going forth when there's some sort of R2 next to R1 or something like that. It would be specific enough to state that it deals with zoning of surrounding properties, and et cetera.
And I think that's helpful for both us and for the hearings official future decisions. The way in which you portray this, and we've got the context piece being kind of critical to your decision here, not to put words in your mouth, but it's possible you might read that policy different with different surrounding properties and different circumstances, if I heard you, or at least most of you. And I think that's important, because that, I don't think, came through as clear in Benson.
That's what happens when you live the decision you think it is.
Yeah.
Are we ready to vote?
Is this a final vote?
Vote for direction.
We're coming back with a final order.
It will come back with a final order that we will then vote on.
Well, I sort of agree with something that Commissioner Mills had stated. I could support such a motion for this particular site, but I would like to really clearly see what the findings are to support that, and I don't want them to lead to the precedent that a lot of the statements in the Willackenzie area plan aren't mandatory, aren't this, and aren't required. I don't think we're saying that. I think we're saying in this specific case, they may not apply.
Mm-hmm. Commissioner Mills.
I guess I want to jump on that bandwagon a little bit, too. We've said a lot of things that are critical of the Willikinsey area plan, and all of the neighborhood plans are suffering from age and need to be redone. But that doesn't minimize their or reduce their importance in terms of trying to understand what the people in these areas want and expect in the areas they live. So those are still very, very high on my list of things that I refer to try to understand where we're going.
Okay. You ready to vote? All those in favor of the motion to remove site review from this zone change, raise your hand. Okay. Motion carries. So then, Steve, you'll come back to us with the final order.
November 3rd at 11:30. We'll be back with...
Will we see it ahead of time, Steve?
We'll try our best to get it cranked out as early as we can. So, best is going to be the end of the week.
And an attorney said he'd write it all for you.
As long as he's listening to how you want it qualified.
That's right. Okay. I don't think we have any other business then, do we?
No, let's go home.
We're adjourned.
I think we've made enough work for you guys.